After loving the first Dark Forces game to pieces last year, I was hyped to jump into the second game, which I heard was far better. But Dark Forces 2 on PC is an enormous departure from the first entry in just about every way. Gone are the open-ended levels with exploration at the forefront, and with few exceptions, in their place are some of the most railroaded corridors I've seen in a 90s shooter. The game is also transferred into full 3D, which, having come out in 1997, means it's going to look a bit rough to the modern eye, even if this was one of the best-looking games on the market at the time. Whether you prefer the Doom-style sprites of the last game is down to personal preference, but thankfully DF2 isn't as hard to look at as it could have been. The wholly unique yet thematically consistent OST of the original game is also gone, with 2's score mostly consisting of remixed tracks from the films. What this game adds are, of course, Kyle's newfound Jedi powers, which not only provide the otherwise entirely linear game with a fair bit of replayability, but also decide which path of the Force you'll journey down. Depending on which powers you invest in, you'll either get the dark or light side ending. The narrative is mostly told through brief cutscenes with real actors and really bad CG. The acting is actually almost decent for the era, but there's still plenty of 90s cheese, especially with the villains hamming it up in almost every scene.
Very good, Saris.
While the story itself is mostly a retelling of Episode 6 with a slightly different setting, Kyle is, to me at least, a similarly compelling will-he-won't-he character to Luke, since his background as a mercenary and especially an ex-Imperial give more credence to his anti-heroic tendencies. Luke changes significantly off-screen between Episodes 5 and 6, from a plucky yet immature neophyte with a heart of gold to a black-clad Jedi who's force-choking Gamorreans, threatening to kill Jabba, and then massacring his entire barge, including plenty of innocent partygoers. Kyle, on the other hand, is a battle-hardened Imperial defector turned mercenary who doesn't really know his place in the universe, or even really want to think about it. Suddenly, he has power like he's never known before, and all his mentors are dead. The only thing left grounding him is Jan. Turning to the dark side makes sense for his character. The story also gets some of the finer points of Star Wars lore correct, like the Sith sacrifice, but at the same time making it so that you can become a full-fledged Jedi just because you, like, super want to? All you gotta do is, like, believe in yourself, bitch! I guess Kyle went to the Sabine Wren school of Jedi-ing. While the plot is a bit more impressive than the first game, it still almost entirely serves as a way to get Kyle from one level to the next. But those levels, linear as they are, lack the polish of Dark Forces. A lot of sloppy design will lead to frustrating deaths and even potential softlocks if you're not saving in multiple slots, and some methods of progression are borderline absurd in their obscurity. I was at least, with one exception, able to finish the game without a guide, but only by being incredibly stubborn. While there were plenty of puzzles and labyrinthine design in Dark Forces, your goal was always clearly laid out in front of you, and you could complete your mission with just a little patience and guile. Dark Forces 2's level design feels less like an enigma to be unraveled and more like a game of Where's Waldo while trying to navigate an Escher canvas. The linear approach does at least allow for a few cool set-piece moments, like rushing to escape from a ship as it's crashed into the ground. But those occasions are few and far between, and in the interim, little is done to spice up the bare-bones level design. There's also a lot more platforming than in Dark Forces, but thankfully Kyle controls remarkably well, even coming at this game from a modern lens. The boss fights are easily the weakest part of the experience, though. Each fight degenerates into an endless repetition of baiting out an attack so that you can attack back. Your guns and most of your powers are rendered almost entirely useless in these sections as well, especially if you went light side. Despite how immersive I imagine it would have felt at the time, at the end of the day it's just a methodical game of Ring Around the Rosie that isn't any fun and lasts for a long time, especially once you get to Darth Jerek the Spongy. The environments also pale in comparison to Dark Forces. There are only 3 planets that you visit instead of the 14 in the original, and while they do their best to have some variety and scenery, it still lacks the appeal of the galaxy-spanning adventure of the first game. In the end, Dark Forces 2 is simply a less tight package than its predecessor, losing almost everything that made its forebear an exciting, memorable experience, while doing little to add its own flavor to the mix. I know that all sounds quite critical, but I still think Dark Forces 2 is a good game that I can recommend to a lot of Star Wars fans. It just may not hold up as well as its contemporary reviews would lead you to believe, and unlike the first game, you'll need to bring both your love of Star Wars and a wellspring of patience to fully enjoy this game. Star Wars Jedi Knight Dark Forces 2 is going in the upper B tier. Those who have played this game before may have noticed that this isn't what the original game looks like. Despite Dark Forces 2 being infamously difficult to get running on modern systems, I played through the entire original game on Steam without any issues earlier this year. Then when I tried to boot it up for recording, it crashed every time I got to gameplay. Go figure, I haven't even updated my driver since then. I installed this quote-unquote remaster called Jedi Knight Remastered by General Tantor in an effort to get it working. And not only is this one of the sloppiest, most amateurish mods I've seen in a while that effectively makes the game look like a Unity asset flip, the game still crashed after 15 minutes. Plus, I couldn't even get the damn thing to display in full screen. Definitely don't recommend. Try and find some other method of getting the game running, because this ain't it, Chief. The Super Dimension Fortress Macross Do You Remember Love on Saturn is not only the longest video game title I've ever seen, aside from Peter Jackson's King Kong, the official game of the movie, but it's also a tie-in game to the Macross film that was never localized in the West, so this game was also never brought over. And I can't say I really blame them. Do You Remember Love, for those who aren't familiar, is an alternate history retelling of the original Macross story. You will need to watch the OG show to understand anything that's going on, but its eye-popping animation and emotional score make it a classic in the mecha genre, just like the original Macross. Its game, however, doesn't live up to the film's brilliance. At first, it seems like this is the full package. Impressive 2.5D graphics, original voice actors, and cutscenes ripped from the movie, plus an entirely new intro sequence that was animated for the game. Then you keep playing and realize that the gameplay is utter nonsense. It's not even that bad, per se, it's just nearly non-existent. Near as I can tell, your objective mostly revolves around not letting the Zentradi get past you and attack the SDF-1. But most of them are in the background, meaning that they're no threat to you, and you can only shoot them with missiles. The few pilots that do show up to challenge you have patterns straight out of Baby's First Shmup, even more so than the GBA game. Not only that, it's nearly impossible to let the SDF-1 die, especially in the early levels. The gameplay is a total sham, and only keeps you engaged for a couple minutes until you realize that you aren't actually doing much of anything. I truly don't know what could possess a developer to make a shmup this vapid. My only guess is that these fighting game devs simply had no idea what they were doing when it came to this genre. There's also no replayability whatsoever. The harder modes only make you take more damage, but with the bridge officers constantly dropping health for you, it's not any more difficult, and the game can be beaten in about an hour, or maybe a bit longer if you die after you get up to get a drink or something. The final boss is the only part of the game that requires you to even momentarily engage with it. It's honestly hard to believe that this is the same dev that made Xenogears just a few years before. Running guns and shmups are practically cousins, there's really no excuse here. Not even my personal attachment to the license saves this game for me. DYRL looks and sounds like the real deal, but plays like a barely interactive movie. If that's what they were going for, then more power to them, I guess, but plenty of other Macross games have succeeded at making a shooter that's both cinematic and engaging. Do You Remember Love is a D+. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2003 on GBA would be considered a classic if it had released on the SNES. This is the side-scroller that I've been waiting for with this franchise. It has buttery animation, a kick-ass soundtrack, and arcadey gameplay with just the right bit of challenge. I'd expect nothing less from a Konami that's firing on all cylinders. Each turtle has four unique missions to complete, including a vehicle level, meaning there's 16 levels of ninjutsu action all culminating in a final epic showdown with Shredder. It's absolutely awesome. The only problem I have with this game is that there's a crowd control attack that actually does damage to you when you hit enemies with it. I don't know what lapse in sanity caused this decision. If you don't want people to spam it, then just put it on a timer. You can at least still use it to deflect projectiles, which I guess was its intended purpose. Regardless, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles on GBA is fan-freaking-tastic and puts the console version to shame. I might end up dropping it later, but for now it's going in the lower A tier. Pizza Power! I know. How could a TMNT fan have never played the arcade Turtles in Time? Truth be told, I don't know. I just didn't have the opportunity until now. But playing this game with a buddy early on this year, and having since played a number of other beat-em-ups, I can see why it's still touted as a genre classic. The charming visuals combined with an ample supply of fresh locales, environmental obstacles and secrets, flawlessly paced gameplay, tight controls, and all of it brought together by one of the bumpinest OSTs I've ever heard make every second of this game a joy to play. If I had any criticism at all, it would be that the game could use just a touch more enemy variety, as even though they have a lot of differing weaponry, you'll still just be fighting your typical foot goons throughout most of the game. Also, at a few points, some bosses can turn a bit quarter-eaty rather than skillful, but frankly that's me reaching for something to nitpick. If you grab a friend or three, and especially if you play it on a genuine machine, Turtles in Time will be some of the best 40 minutes you'll ever spend gaming. A+. The Chronicles of Narnia, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe on GBA kinda surprised me. Instead of going the typical side-scrolling brawler or platformer route of licensed GBA games, Narnia is an isometric action-adventure game. You start off fairly weak, just trying to survive as Lucy and explore your environment to complete puzzles and find items. In particular, you have a heat gauge that you have to keep a constant eye on, because if your body temperature drops too low, you start to lose life, so you have to sit at bonfires or eat warm food to keep yourself from freezing, which forces you to be cautiously efficient about how you explore, but you rarely feel terribly pressed on time and resources. This is a decent way to adapt to source material, as you really feel like you have to explore Narnia to the fullest. The combat also works well, especially for a game like this, but the challenge remains fairly minimal, especially once you start unlocking more powers and get control over the older Pevensey kids. The game follows the plot of the movie with little deviation, which leads to a tight experience with even a few set pieces along the way. And the game never dragged aside from maybe the very combat-focused penultimate level, but there's also no story expansion to be found. After about the halfway point, the gameplay failed to keep me engaged, and I was more than ready for the game to be over by the time I reached the end. I don't know what else to say, honestly. I was originally going to give it a high C since it's a perfectly good game, but at the end of the day I found it to be pretty boring a lot of the time, and a bare-bones retelling of the movie's story wasn't enough to make up for the mostly humdrum gameplay. A lack of gameplay evolution in the second half really brought down the experience for me. If I had a blandest award of the year like Yahtzee, this game would probably take it. I think by the end it'll be right in the middle of the C tier. House of the Dead 4 is probably my favorite game in the series, when played in the arcade. The shooting feels tight, the graphics were astounding, and the game is a solid length while providing a fun and fair difficulty level. Plus, it just skips the weak shit and gives you a Mach 10 right off the rip. Unfortunately, I played the PS3 version this time around. There are some benefits to this edition, like Special being included in the package, but the biggest problem isn't with the game itself, it's with the hardware. Instead of going the Namco route and making a light gun that could only be used with one or two games, Sony and Sega decided to just make the game use the PS Move. What was a satisfying challenge in the arcade becomes a frustrating and unfair slog on the PS3. The PS Move simply doesn't have the precision or responsiveness to play a game like this, and it really drags down the whole experience. Plus, I don't know what happened to the audio mixing, or maybe the speakers of the arcade just carried it, but the sound design is total crap. The guns sound closer to paintball than actual firearms, which creates a pretty big dissonance compared to their in-game efficacy. And the soundtrack is an impotent one-note techno mix that fades into the background in all of 5 minutes. If you can't live without a home version, then this port will do you just fine, but the game just doesn't play very well. Plus, having it be released after Overkill makes the whole thing feel a bit lackluster by comparison. It was a big mistake to take so long to port it. I'll stick it in the B tier. The Operative, No One Lives Forever is one of those games that just slipped through the cracks. Despite releasing during the boom of first-person shooters in the late 90s and early aughts, and receiving critical acclaim at the time, this game has since faded into obscurity, with only a small but fervent fanbase carrying on its legacy. That stops now, because if there's one game from this list that I think everyone watching this should play, it's this. Not only because of the game's quality, but also because it's more or less free. NOLF is in complete and total IP limbo, such that even the people who are supposed to know these things have absolutely no idea who owns the rights to this game, if anyone. They've also showed little interest in unraveling this complex web, meaning that this game and its sequels are effectively orphaned works or abandonware. Thus, there is no legal concern with playing it. There's been a lot of community support to bring the Operative up to a working state on modern machines, and it now plays brilliantly. If you want to download and play this game, go to nolfrevival.tk. That's nolfrevival.tk. I'll also put the link in the description. And with that, on to the game. The Operative stars Kate Archer, an ex-cat burglar turned fledgling super spy trying to work her way up the ladder of Unity, a secret organization dedicated to world peace. Unfortunately for her, this is 1967, and the higher-ups are reluctant to give her the responsibility she feels she deserves, a point of tension throughout most of the game. Meanwhile, Unity's elite agents start turning up dead with little evidence to go off of, and Kate is called into the field for the first time. From there begins a globe-trotting adventure of massive proportions to try and stop the evil harm from bringing the world to its knees, with plenty of twists, turns, and maybe a bit of romance along the way. The Operative's tone falls smack dab in the middle of James Bond and Austin Powers, never taking itself too seriously, but never truly devolving into madness either, which gives it a campy, over-the-top feel that's perfect for a charming spy adventure with its fair share of both engaging plot beats and laugh-out-loud moments. While the campaign is linear, most levels allow you to take the stealth approach or go full-on guns blazing, sometimes requiring one or the other. Most of the guns also have their own unique feel and are useful for different scenarios, plus they can be loaded with several ammo types that have differing effects. Of course, you'll also have a number of gadgets to play with, like a barrette that doubles as a lockpick and a poison blade, disintegrating power to help you go unnoticed, exploding lipstick, a robotic poodle, and so much more. The lengthy campaign provides a lot of cool set-piece moments to break things up, like fighting a helicopter on a motorcycle or trying to survive a plane crash without a parachute. Plus, there are a number of wacky boss fights. The plot has as many gotchas as you'd expect out of a spy thriller, but the real star here is Kate herself. It's rare to see such an excellent female character in a video game, or anywhere for that matter. Kate is a woman in a man's world, and your co-workers and bosses will never let you forget that. Their bias is clearly on display, especially as Kate's earlier assignments go off the rails. As the game continues and Kate is able to prove her competency more and more, you start to see them change their tune. Kate herself also matures as the game goes on, from an impatient and reckless rookie with a quick wit that can get her into trouble, to a seasoned professional able to stay composed under the harshest circumstances. The game also doesn't go too far out of its way to sexualize Kate or make it so that she has to use her womanly wiles in order to succeed, but doesn't make her sex inconsequential either. It masterfully toes the line of not beating you over the head that you're in control of a badass female protagonist, while at the same time giving Kate flaws and shortcomings that make her feel like a real person instead of a Barbie doll or an emotionless husk. She's just a well-written character regardless of her sex, and that's something that, especially in the modern day, we could use a lot more examples of. MILF does have some shortcomings that it's only fair to mention. While the game rarely forces you to be stealthy, the vision of the guards and cameras feels widely variable, and can lead to some frustrating moments, especially if you're not one to hammer the quicksave button. But the better you do in each mission, the better Kate gets at remaining unnoticed, along with increased health and accuracy. The levels just don't seem very well balanced for a stealth approach, though, especially in the early game. If you want to do the majority of missions without being noticed, then you better be willing to give the quicksave button a workout, and maybe have a lesser focus on full-level completion. While the game does reward the stealthy approach with optional conversations and an easier time through the levels, you really aren't given enough tools to make it a fun stealth experience. I'd recommend going stealth until you get caught and then going guns blazing for the rest of the level. Then you can try to do a full stealth run on your second playthrough once you already have a good feel for the game. Most of those are just nitpicks, though. Probably the single thing that prevents the Operative from being an S tier is that it's missing something every truly great FPS needs: interesting enemies to fight. This is why it's difficult to make an amazing FPS in a realistic setting. Aside from differing weaponry, you never have to deal with a real person in any alternative way. All the enemies are the same, meaning all you have to do is shoot them in the face, which drastically reduces the number of decisions you need to make mid-combat. For comparison, I'm never going to take out all the grunts first so that I can deal with the elite one-on-one, and I'm never forced to get dangerously up close with a hunter so that I can do damage to it. Even though you can switch up your weapons and ammo type, you're never going to feel the need to do so in order to deal with a new threat. When enemies are based off of real people, they're just never going to be as interesting as the alternative. Games that do manage to pull this off are, of course, hero shooters. You're never going to go about killing a Mercy and a Genji in the same way. Not only that, how you interact with them changes based on the character that you're playing. I'm not saying we need to make every FPS a hero shooter, just that there's a reason class-based enemies feel so much better to shoot than your standard goons. With a game like this that doesn't take itself too seriously, you could have had some more Team Fortress 2-esque character designs that still function as real people, but have to be approached in different ways. Sadly though, like nearly every realistic shooter, the enemies start to become benozic after a while. The soundtrack, while used intelligently, could use a bit of work, as the OST is too short for such a long game. The Operative also starts out pretty slow, with a mandatory tutorial section followed by a lethargic, boring escort quest as your first assignment. But once you get past that, the game puts you in the saddle, and from there you're hooked. I had the distinct misfortune of playing the game for the first time on the PS2. Do not, under any circumstances, do this. Aside from the awful performance and lack of quicksaving, the game doesn't give you the option to choose your loadout before going on a mission, which also means that you have almost no gadgets throughout the entire game, because everything has to be found in the levels. This completely ruins a large part of the gameplay. As impressive as it was that they even managed to put it on the system, this is effectively the Deus Ex the Conspiracy port of MILF. It's a gimped experience that I'm sure ruined many people's first impressions of the game, same as it did mine. So again, make sure you play it on PC via the link in the description. I'm putting the Operative No One Lives Forever in the A tier. So, 95% of you are probably thinking, what the hell is even this? The other 5%,
yo, what's up, how you doing?
The Typing of the Dead is an official mod slash re-release of The House of the Dead 2 by Sega that changes the game so that instead of shooting zombies with a light gun, you shoot them by typing on a keyboard.
And I love it.
This is a game I like to bring out at parties for the simple what the f*** factor of it all. The House of the Dead 2 is already incredibly wacky with the general nonsense of its plot and the voice acting that's so insanely terrible it makes the room look like Macbeth.
To protect the life cycle, I have made a creature to rule over mankind.
Add on that you have a keyboard that the in-game characters have plugged into a Dreamcast backpack powered by an enormous D battery, but still shoot them like a gun for some reason? Plus the enormous library of words and phrases that can go from insulting your mom to informing you about a rare medical disease to what appears to be a developer's desperate cry for help in the span of a minute. And this game is just peak Sega. It's also damn tough. Since this is a home port, I had to one credit clear the game. And let me tell you, this game is so hard it's like the Dark Sector of edutainment games. But Dark Sector is just really hard to finish because of how painfully mediocre it is. If only there was some game I could compare it to the difficulty of. Anyway, I typed it 85 words per minute, but I still needed to put more than a dozen attempts into this game to finally beat it. And oh, did it feel sweet. I took down the final boss with literally one hit left. There are also some cool unlockables and extra modes once you beat the game. Honestly, I think TTOTD only has one problem. The game makes you type punctuation, but not spaces or capitalizations. Personally, I still typed them out because it would have messed me up more than it would have helped to try and skip them, but this limits the game's potential as an edutainment game. So far as I know, there's no option to require these, which is a bit disappointing. Otherwise, I can't really find fault with it. This is one of the most fun games on the Dreamcast, and it'll turn you into a typing phenom before you see the final credits. The only issue at this point is accessibility. Without finding an arcade machine or paying upwards of $150 for a genuine keyboard and copy of the game, your only other option is emulation, as it has yet to see a release on Steam or GOG. Hopefully they'll get around to adding this game soon, because everyone should experience this fever dream of a game. In the meantime, the typing version of Overkill got a Steam release, so you can still go there for your keyboard zombie shooting action. I was originally going to give the Typing of the Dead a B+, but at the end I'll probably switch it out for TMNT. Alright, I'm gonna show my bias here. Trials Evolution is easily one of, if not the best game on the entire Xbox 360 arcade. The physics-based 2D racing provides some of the best gameplay around, whether you want a nice drive in the park, a teeth-grinding challenge, or anything in between. Plus, the physics almost never bug out or feel unfair. The levels have an insane amount of visual variety, and many feature their own individual music. Plus, you can play the overabundance of minigames to switch up the gameplay, some of which are so in-depth that you could release them as entirely separate games. If you still haven't had enough, there's a built-in level editor for you to make your own trials. As of now, the servers have been shut down, so you can no longer download other people's custom tracks, but there is an archive of 700 custom tracks on the Steam forums. I'll put a link to that in the description. On Xbox 360, there were two DLC packs released that more or less added a whole nother game on top of the original, but for reasons unknown, probably because Ubisoft is a crime against gamerkind, they were never put on the PC edition. The 360 version and its DLC are no longer available for purchase, but there are of course ways to get around that. Trials Evolution is the ultimate combination of racing and physics-based platformer that still hasn't been topped, even by its later entries. If you haven't played it, you're doing yourself a disservice. A+ tier, baby! The literal only thing that keeps this game from being an S tier is the lack of a narrative, but damn if I'm not thinking about amending that rule. Okay, cards on the table, X-Men Legends was one of the first games I finished last year, and I didn't write down any of my thoughts at the time, which means I've forgotten a lot about what I wanted to say, but I'll give it my best shot. X-Men Legends on Xbox is a 4-player co-op dungeon crawler ARPG set in the X-Men universe, featuring 15 playable characters. All the usual suspects are here, along with some deeper cuts like Psylocke and Magma, the latter of which serves as the player character, but isn't required for most of the game. The gameplay is your standard dungeon crawler fare, a focus on combat and a bit of exploration while trying to complete objectives and stop the Brotherhood from their latest evil scheme to give mutants basic human rights and dignity. This is what makes X-Men such an interesting world. It generally handles the civil rights allegory with tact and depth, putting you right in the middle of the philosophical conflicts between MLK Jr. and Malcolm X, while at the same time not sounding preachy. This game has a surprisingly few number of pulled punches as well. Magneto's plan is one of his most non-violent yet, using innovative means to force Earth into an ultimatum without any civilian casualties. At the same time, the Brotherhood and even some more moderate mutants that you fight aren't afraid of calling you naive, pathetic, ineffectual race traitors. Like every good X-Men adaptation, this gets the player to question whether or not they're truly on the right side. What's more important, pacifism or efficacy? Why should endless mutants suffer in the hopes of a more peaceful transition while everyone drags their feet? Where do you draw the line between those with outspoken hatred, those that quietly vote with their, well, votes, and those who are willfully ignorant? Are they not all doing the same damage? Oh, sorry, I'm not towing the line here.
Dagnabbit, keep the dang politics out of my video games!
There we go. Anyway, where the game falls down in the storytelling is when you're not on missions. There's very little dialogue fleshing out the characters and circumstances of the world. You just have a mostly empty school full of people that refuse to talk to you. I wish this game focused less on the dungeon crawling and more on the RPG side of this ARPG. There are no meaningful choices to make in the narrative, and there's very little focus on the plot or characters in general. It mostly just serves as a brief interlude before you get back to the gameplay, which is where most of my problems with the game arise. The levels are just a bit overlong, which even in the early game can lead to some boredom and monotony, but that would be fixed with a decent combat system. X-Men Legends sports the opposite, though. You'll mostly be mashing your basic combos or throwing in a power every so often depending on the character, and that's about it. Aside from the visuals, the enemies don't provide anything in the way of variety, as they can all be dealt with in the same way, and you never have to change your playstyle aside from maybe switching characters if an enemy is resistant to your damage type. The friendly AI is also quite poor. They'll rarely try to combo with you and typically either get in your way or do their best to soak up as much damage as possible, while draining you of all your heals. Yeah, just like Brute Force, the AI will stand still and use nearly all of your health potions rather than repositioning or running away, which can make some less balanced sections quite annoying, especially in the early game. The enemies are also fairly block-happy with no real way to break their guard, meaning that a lot of the slower characters, including my personal favorite ex-person, Rogue, are nearly unusable, or at least they're far less effective. The level design can also drag down the experience. A lot of the time you need a specific power in order to cross a gap, move something, weld something together, etc. But there's no easy way to tell which characters can do what without switching to them and diving into their upgrade pages. For example, I know that Cyclops can reduce the power of his optic blasts to weld, but without that knowledge of the character, I'd have to cycle through all the X-Men, look at their upgrade trees, and then find the one ability that says it can weld. It's also often nonsensical which powers can perform which tasks. This is made worse by the fact that you can't change team members whenever you like. You have to backtrack all the way to a save point, which could be 2 or 3 minutes back through the level. Same thing happens whenever a squadmate dies. If you want to get them back, you have to trek to a save point and either revive them, which uses a lot of resources, or pick a new squadmate. But wait, if there's only one squadmate with the proper powers to complete the level, what happens if they die and you don't have the resources to revive them? Well, great question. I guess you have to restart the entire mission then, probably losing somewhere between 10 minutes to half an hour of progress. I recognized this as a possibility early on and ensured that I never revived a squadmate if I didn't have to, which meant that I never had to restart a level. But I'm sure other people weren't so lucky. Word of the wise, whoever was working on the early levels hardcore stand Iceman, for some reason, I'm sure, so you're going to need to use him a lot. Especially in the early levels, make sure that he's with you and that you keep him alive. While I was playing this game, I remember the phrase that kept coming back to me was death by a thousand cuts. This game would be such a great experience if it didn't have so many little things holding it back. If the design had been just a bit stronger, then this would be a game that I could recommend to everyone. As it is, though, X-Men Legends remains a strong overall package for fans of the IP, especially those who don't want to play yet another fighting game, but doesn't separate itself enough from the crowd to be a great game in its own right. X-Men Legends is a B tier, maybe a high B, we'll see. Man, I could have sworn there was one more. Some game that was, like, life-changing or something like that? What was that called again? How do you even begin to talk about a game like Xenogears? Where do you start? As many have found out, where can you stop? How does a fresh-faced team that had never worked on 3D games before and a rookie writer-director with mere graphics work to his name, with a development time of only 2 years, make a game like this? How do games like this even get made? That's a great question, and truthfully, I don't know, but maybe we can find a hint. How did a brand new studio throw this together in 14 months? How was this trilogy made cohesive even with shorter and shorter dev times combined with increasing demands from the publisher? How did this last-ditch effort from a failed director and a developer about to go under manage to change gaming forever? My answer is conflict. Constraints breed creativity. You can have all the time and money, all the genes, all the mentors, all the advantages in the world, but all it will create is stagnation and complacency. Only when human beings are put under pressure can we truly shine. Only when we're put in a do-or-die situation will we know what we're truly capable of. Lucky for us, we're all gonna die one day. Sooner than we think. That inevitability, that fear, shouldn't be paralytic. Such notions are illogical. It should be the kick in the ass we need to give everything we do our all. Push harder, do more than you thought you could. Bury your fangs at God, unafraid of the consequences. That's why games that aren't afraid to fail, that aren't afraid to shoot for the stars and land on the moon, will always stand peerless among the masses. Xenogears is the most ambitious game of all time. Few would argue this. The utterly batshit plot takes 15,000 years to unfold. Every small detail recontextualizing historical events, characters, the nature of the very world itself. All of this culminating in a philosophical dialectic that would make the Brothers Karamazov blush, resulting in unparalleled thematic poignancy. This is one of the most complex interweaving narratives I've ever encountered in any medium. I've often said that Xenogears feels like archaeology. You uncover a tiny piece of the picture, which then leads to myriad discoveries that make you reconsider everything you thought you knew about this universe. Every minute detail so carefully placed, every new revelation making you crave more. You'll have to claw your way through broken katakana, esoteric references to long-dead religions, on-the-fly translation work, entire schools of thought far into the West, a fan-translated 300-page lore book, and yet, all you can do is keep going. Playing Xenogears feels like how some people have described having an epileptic seizure. Your mind goes into overdrive, it starts creating connections, you see patterns that you never could before. You feel like every secret of the universe is splayed out before you in all of its inconceivable splendor, that you're on the very precipice of discovering everything you want to know about life, and then you black out. You know, minus the blacking out bit, typically. There is endless depth here to explore, such that I don't think I'll ever fully grasp everything that's attempting to be conveyed, and yet I simply can't stop. An art piece hasn't given me a feeling like this since the Drakenir saga. Something that I could sink my teeth into for years and still never get to the bottom of, and yet it's so much fun to try. There are times when I stopped playing this game to read entire other books, sometimes entire other bodies of work just to try and understand it that little bit better. I've watched every video, every interview, listened to every podcast, read every essay, forum post, and design doc, and still, I feel like I've barely scratched the surface. I'd like to do a full video on this game someday, but frankly, even if that video were 20 hours long, I don't think I could do it justice. So, the story's pretty good. The dialogue isn't just used to craft one of the deepest narratives of all time. Xenogears is also one of the funniest games I've ever played. It's so rare for comedy to be done right, especially in video games, but even despite the typical cultural disconnect present in a lot of Japanese media, this game has a plethora of laugh-out-loud moments that still manage to not undercut the story and keep the tone on pace in a way that very few stories in any medium have achieved. For the most part, I found the battle system to be enjoyable enough for the runtime. Though it's lacking in depth compared to a lot of JRPGs, the pure visual luster on display is unmatched by almost anything else in the genre. But the game's balance is where it really stands out. The encounters are utterly flawless. You understand each new mechanic at exactly the right time, which makes every decision, every battle, an absolute nail-biter as you barely scrape by. And yet, this is without grinding even a single time. I think I only died a grand total of 5 times in this game, but every fight was dripping with intensity. This might even challenge Panzer Dragoon Saga as the most perfectly balanced RPG I've ever played. There's two completely different battle systems that switch up your playstyle and decision-making process as you go from ground to gear battles. Plus, there's so many little change-ups to the regular gameplay with mini-games and set pieces. I mean, there's an entire 3D fighting game inside of this 80-hour RPG that could be its own separate game, and still somehow runs at a stable FPS. Like, Takahashi, you madman, what are you doing? The truncated nature of every dungeon makes sense with a fairly high encounter rate. At the end of the day, that's just a limitation of the hardware, but each level still manages to draw you in with its wide range of settings and aesthetics that don't waste a moment of environmental storytelling. The 3D levels combined with 2D sprites allowed for a level of cinematography that RPGs with pre-rendered backgrounds couldn't have dreamt of at the time. It also has the second best soundtrack I've ever heard. Every song is iconic and enhances the mood of each scene while still being eclectic, listenable, and containing multiple standout tracks. I played the game over a year ago and I could still name every song on this OST. On top of that, the impactful sound design makes every punch, whip, and reality-melting laser sound suitably weighty. Are there things to criticize about this game? Probably. Most of what I've heard I don't agree with, though. I was expecting Disc 2 to be a complete shitshow based on how it's spoken about, but it's not. For those who aren't familiar with Xenogears, a lot of this game had to be cut down as the devs ran out of time, and the second disc is where that cut content really shows. due to the lack of a PC release, it also has never gotten the same kind of restoration effort as something like KOTOR 2, meaning that Disc 2 of Xenogears has become fairly infamous in the JRPG community. At the end of the day, though, most of what was cut from the game are several endgame dungeons, and I for one think the game is a stronger overall package because of it. The combat system was starting to wear a bit in the final hours, especially the final dungeon, which just doesn't want to end. If those extra dungeons were still in the game, it would have slowed down the pace to a crawl, and you'd really have to drag yourself toward the end credits. Most of those dungeons have little of consequence to do with the narrative as well, mostly just serving as fetch quests. This lapse in gameplay also serves as a nice break before the laborious trek through the final area. Even if it was out of necessity, Xenogears is a much better 80-hour game than 110 hours. A lot of people have also complained about the platforming, and frankly my response would be skill issue. I think I missed two jumps in the entire game, and even when you fail, it's little more than a minor inconvenience. There are some characters that are unfortunately forgotten about before their arcs can be fully completed, and that's a real shame. But at the same time, you can already infer most of what would have happened. Honestly, one of the only major mistakes in the final product for me was the removal of Stars of Tears. The intro was certainly not too long already for a JRPG. Even if it was, it would just take a small revision and structure to fix, and the omission of one of the best songs in the game was a clumsy misstep. The only other thing that was a bit disappointing for me is the lack of a strong ludonarrative. The story mostly doesn't justify itself as a game, and while I don't think it would be a better art piece in a different medium, it still fails to use the unique qualities of video games to its advantage. This is the one time I'll make an exception, though, simply because every other aspect of this experience is so spot on. I could talk for so much longer, but that would honestly be doing this game a disservice. Xenogears is a once-in-a-lifetime experience. It's incredibly rare that everything can come together like this and make a game that's so far and above nearly everything else out there, and there will never be anything else like it. Everyone who's watching this, if you don't play Xenogears at some point in your life, then I would question how you're choosing to spend it. Is this a game that everyone will like? Hell no. Loving this game, even just playing it, is a lot of work, but that's the same for everything worthwhile in life. Go play it, watch the Retrograde Amnesia and Resonant Arc podcasts, probably take some courses on Gnosticism, Kabbalah, Anthropology, Metaphysics, Neurology, Post-Structuralism, Psychoanalysis, Existentialism, Critical Theory, and about 1,000 other things, then come back and let's talk about it for the next few years. Xenogears is an S tier, it's my game of the year, and it's my third favorite game of all time. Let me just switch some things around here, and there we go. Those are my final rankings for every game I finished in 2023. Thank you guys so much for watching. Let me know why you agree or disagree with my rankings down in the comments. For those of you who prefer actual numbers, this is what that would look like. Hopefully, if our opinions differ wildly, you can at least see where I'm coming from. I think it's especially important to remember that, unlike gaming journalists, I use the entire 0 to 10 scale instead of just the top half, so my number rankings are going to be lower than what you'd see on Metacritic, for example. Again, everything above 7.5 I'd consider a must-play. Just something to keep in mind. And with that, we're finally done. Holy shit, this has been easily the longest project in this channel's history. I'm definitely going to be working on the next ranking video over the course of the year instead of just trying to cram it into the last couple months because this has really burned me out. As such, videos are going to slow down a bit. I was giving myself around 2 months for each video the previous year, but I'm done with schedules. I'm just gonna work on a video, and when it's done, it's done. So yeah, next thing that's coming down the pipe is that Enslaved review. When will it be done? No clue. Stay tuned. Again, thank you guys for watching. I really appreciate it. Hopefully you guys found this interesting. It's been fun for me to just rave about the games that I love and rage at the games that I hate, and overall just kind of get my thoughts in order on everything. And with that, now that it's past Valentine's Day, on to a new year!